Welcome to my talk about testing and infrastructure. I'm Sandra Pasek. I'm working as a freelance software developer in a Java environment in Germany. Mein main focus is in developing Java Enterprise application, mostly in backend. I like to develop it in agile methods and in software craftsmanship rules, and I often helps my customer to automate their development process. So when you need some buzzwords, they are continuous delivery, continuous integration, or DevOps. Yeah, I give some trainings, workshop. I'm one of the organizers of the SoftwareXCammer Ruhr area. It's a software craftsmanship group in Germany. I'm a member of the Oracle Groundbreakers program, and you can find me on Twitter, write me an email, and sometimes I write some blog posts. So let's start with a little bit with the motivation for this talk. My motivation was, I was thinking about, I will not make this talk when we developed some application without interaction with each other's services. That means when I have an application that run for itself, I will not make this talk. Question to you, who's developed such kinds of application? No, not two kinds. But when I look at my project, we develop application that has many interaction with other services. I have to send some emails or receive some emails. I have to interact with the database, with JMS, or sometimes I have to provide or to offer own endpoints for my customer. Question to you, do you develop such kind of application? Yes. So this is the reason why I like to talk about this topic. But when I look outside the software, we develop more and more infrastructure in code. And so a good question is how to test it. I mean, code without tests is very hard to maintain. So then on the next point is why I should not use the best practice that I collected during the years with clean code and so on, why I cannot reuse it, this concept for infrastructure as code. So in my talk, we will have a look on first inside the software, how to write tests inside the software with interact with the infrastructure, and then we will see how I can test my infrastructure as code. So when I look in my current project, I often find follow situation. The interaction with infrastructure are tested very late in the projects or in the process, so the feedback in case of errors are very late. So maybe they came from the quality assurance department, and it's during a release process and so on. And when you have some tests, then they are often depend on special infrastructure. Sometimes during the build process, like I can only run my Maven build or Gradle build only when a special infrastructure is up or special service. So the false negative error quote is very high. So maybe the test fails because my database is not up. And then another point is that I have a very complex setup. And the next point is that my test execution is very slow, so I don't like to run those tests because the feedback time is very, very slow. So before we go deeper on this topic, I want to make a definition what kind of tests I want to have. And the situation what you hear before is that these tests are kind of integration tests. They are called integrated tests. And I like the definition of Rainsberger that say, okay, integrated tests is a subset of integration tests, but with many problems. And one problem is that integrated tests can fail based on the correctness of other services. And so the next question is, how I can recognize that I have integrated tests. And Spotify writes a blog post about it. They sum up some signs for that. So one sign is I have to spin up some other services in my local environment to run my own test. Or I have to use a shared environment with other developers to run some tests. That's all kind of integrated tests. Or when I make some change on the other systems and my test breaks, so that I have also a sign of integrated test. So when we look in the situation, what would you have? I see we are very good in writing integration tests between classes. There are no problems. Many developers have no problems with that, or for unit testing. But I always say that we always see that we have problems to write tests for classes that interact with the infrastructure. So the question is how I can solve it. So before I want to show you some solutions, let's clarify the requirements. So one requirement from my side is I want to have a build that runs independent from other systems. So the reason is I want to minimize my false negatives errors. So when an error is coming up, I want to be sure that's coming from my implementation, not from other systems. And the next point is I want to be decoupled from other developers. I don't want to have the situation that my test or my implementation is not running because other developers are working on the same piece of systems. And I want fast feedback in case of error as soon as possible. The perfect point would be my local machine. And of course, I want to speed up my test execution. I'd like to show you three use cases. One will be how to handle with HTTP calls as a server and as a client. The next point is I want to show you how to handle with emails, and I think it's a classic use case. What about databases? Let's go deeper to HTTP. So one possible solution is when I use other services, I can mock the HTTP calls. And the idea behind that is that I have my system under test, and every call outside going to a mock server where I can set up expectation, and I get for specific requests the same response every time. There are two libraries outside that I know, mock server and WireMock. They are works similar, but I want to show you on a mock server how to use it, this kind of libraries. So mock server provides Java and Java script RPs. Some has Java rules, so I can integrate it in my JUnit tests. I can use it in my Maven as a Maven plugin, npm plugin as a standalone, or like it's common nowadays as a Docker container. So how mock server works? Mock server in mock server you describes which kind of request the mock server should match, and when this request coming into the mock server, he always sends a specific response back. And so I can rerun my tests with very minimized setup against this mock server. And the next point is I can also write request matcher that should send an error. So I have the possibility to test my business logic if it can handle with errors from the other systems. So let's have an example. My third party RP should be in this case the Star Wars RP. Who is a Star Wars fan here? Okay, many. Star Trek? Okay, both. Okay, great. So we have a Star Wars RP. In this case, I like to collect the starships of the movies. So I get a result with some information about the starship. in which film they flight, about the pilots, how many passenger, or how many member of the crew this ship can fly. So I write a Star Wars client that it's very easy. It's use some Spring classes like the REST template. So I call the REST RP and map this in my Starship object, and at the end I collect all the Starship and return a list of Starships. And my test looks like here, that I have a mock server rule that I can integrate mock server in my J4 test. I set up my mock server client so I can define, okay, when a request on the get HTTP method is coming on the path RP Starship, then the special response should be returned. And at the end, I can test my client, and at the end, I have test my logic if I can map this the Starship that returned from the RP. So my question to you is, what's wrong here with this example? Do you have some ideas? I hope the syntax is correct. And it's groovy code, yes. Maybe not all fancy features, but I do my best. So the problem with this is I break a rule. The rule is don't mock RP you don't own. Why this rule is important? When I run this test on every development cycle, everything is correct, but it could be that this third-party RP has some change with the time, and I will not recognize because I have a mock on that. So the question is, how can I handle this problem? And one solution is the concept verified fakes. That means I reuse my tests that runs against this mock server and run them against the real RP, for example, once per night. And when this nightly test breaks, I know that I have to change my expectation in mock server. And then I change my mock, my test double, and then I correct my business logic implementation. And so I have the best possibilities of both worlds. I have this fast test execution during my daily work because the mock server is very fast, and at night I get feedback about the changes of the third-party RP. So mock server has more features. One feature is that I can introduce a flag for forward action, and there is a possibility to implement this verified fake so that I can say, hey, during the night, or please enable this forward action and go to a real service and not over your expectation. The next feature of mock server is I can verify how often it's allowed to call the RP. So maybe these RP calls are very expensive, and I want to ensure that they are not called very often. I can write tests where I can make, like I know it from Mockito or something, so that I can verify how often these requests are called in my business logic. Another feature what I really like is mock server proxy. It is useful for reverse engineering. You often have to maintain an application without documentation. Who knows the situation? Yeah, everybody knows it, because we developers don't like writing documentation. With this feature, you can find out which kind of third-party RPs are really call from my system. And then I can then reverse engineering, okay, this RP is used or this RP is not used. Another possibility is to set the mock server before my system, and then can I find out which kind of my own RP is called from the customer. This proxy feature supports many proxying methods like port forwarding, web proxy, SOX proxy. And the other feature is that I can recorded requests and look then verify when I change my business application if my new implementation verify the same requests like with the implementation before. So this is about when I have interact with third-party services. But normally, I have customers and I enabled some HTTP endpoints. And the question is, how can test my endpoints that they match the customer requirements? Usually, use libraries for REST like Jersey or Spring M4C, and they have some own test libraries on that. But they are a framework independent test library called REST Assert, and it brings some Scala support, some Spring M4C support, and the killer feature, the killer feature is the given when then structure. And we have a business logic here. It's a controller that gives a list of Star Wars movies, returns a list of Star Wars movies. And I liked to test it. And I can write a Spring integration test here with my mock M4C. And then I can reuse the REST Assert framework, and then I have this give when then structure. But I think it's very nice to read. But when you look at the compared with the plain mock M4C code, I think this is very hard to read or to maintain. So, and a nice thing is that this matcher, a Helmcrest matcher, so when you use Helmcrest in your unit test, so you don't need to learn new matchers, you can reuse this knowledge on that side. This kind of tests are very expensive because I have to set up the whole application context. So I use this test only to verify if my endpoints looks for the customer like it is expected. And when I want to test my implementation of the controller, or maybe some logic inside, then I use normal unit tests because they are very cheap to run it, and I don't need the whole infrastructure or the whole application context for that. So let's have a look on emails. Emails are often non-tested or very late in the process because we need some mail server setup of the test main server. And there's a possibility in the Java world that we can use the library Greenmail. It's a lightweight sandboxes mail server that I can integrate it in my test. There are some other usage model like standalone or as a Docker container, like it's common today. But I want to show you the Java API on that side. So in this case, I have a simple mail client that sends some emails, and my testing setup. I set up Greenmail. In this case, I have to set up the port offset manually. That's important because I don't want to have an integrated test. Greenmail per default use a fixed port, and this fixed port could be bind from other services on different machines. And this kind of port offset is a very simple implementation. In a real case, you would put more logic inside there. So yeah, I start my Greenmail server, then I test my client. At the end, I can ask Greenmail, hey, do you receive some messages? Yeah, how many? And what was the content about it. And so I have the possibility during my developer test to test this logic against a mail server. and I don't have to wait if there some testers give me feedback in late feedback. Let's come to database. I think database is a classical use cases in this area, and maybe we should have a look on the history of testing with databases. So one solution what I see in my project life is they use embedded database. I have Adobe database integrated in my tests, but there are some pitfalls with that because they are not production related, because maybe in my production I use Oracle or PostgreSQL. That means I cannot test everything because I use some Oracle features. Question to you, who is using embedded databases? Says, yeah, it's a classic one. Another one is I have a standalone database, so it's very common that when I come new in a project, I spend 1-2 days to set up a database on my machine that match the requirements of this project. Yeah, pitfall here, it depends on the specific infrastructure. And the next point is maybe we use a shared developer database, yeah, and then have a close coupling between the developer. And it's very common case that I'm working on the table, my tests are not running, my business code is make some stupid stuff, and at the lunch break I heard from my developer colleague that he is using the same table like me. So yeah, again a high false negative error here. But for our luck, there are test containers. So in this case, I have the possibility because of Docker that I can use my database provider for the production in my developer test. And it looked like in Spock, the Spock integration of test containers, you write a Spock test with annotation test containers, then you say, hey, I want to have a PostgreSQL container, and then I have my repository under test, make some setup stuff like I have to ask the container object here the database connection configuration, and I want to use some database migration scripts to set up the database structure. At the end, I can write my test and say, hey, save the person, find all person, and then make some assertion about that. And then I can be sure that in production this code will be working too, because I use here PostgreSQL database. I can use test containers for other use cases, like to testing my database migration script. In the past, it was very common that the write database migration script, but they are tested very late in the automated process. And now I have the possibility to do it during my build. Again, I have a container. I use the database migration tooling, in this case Flyway, and I wait if all migration script run successful. And so during my build, it looks like that Maven is started a Docker container for me, test container started a Docker container for me, then the migration script run and everything is fine. So I have very early feedback about the status of my database migration script. But there are more features from test containers. I can write Selenium tests with Docker containers. So normally you have somewhere a central Selenium server. They are very often broken because of reasons. And here Docker test containers provides a Selenium Docker container with automated video recording, so you can test. You run the Selenium test on your local machine, and when something is broken, you get a video recording to look where the failure are. There are more special containers for Elasticsearch, for Kafka, so you can write integration tests that interact with this kind of services. And you can use your own Docker containers. So when you have a special container of a service, you can use it also in this library. Or when you like, you can reuse Docker Compose files, or say, hey, test containers, use please this Docker file. But what about legacy test code? I mean, this concept is really nice, but you have a huge test code base that depends on a standalone database or an embedded database, and you don't want to migrate everything to test containers. Yeah, it's a nice tooling, but yeah, it's very hard to explain to the manager why you have to spend time for this migration. But there's a possibility to reuse this concept. And here the Docker Maven plugin can help. Many people know it for building a Docker image during a Maven build, but Docker Maven plugin has also a goal for start and stop containers. And to reuse this concept of test containers, my starting point is that I have some integrated tests against embedded or standalone database, and they are often running in the integration test phase of Maven. And when you look at the in the list of the Maven phases before integrated tests, there are a phase pre-integration tests, and after that a post-integration test. So I want to start a database container in a pre-integration test with the Docker Maven plugin, and in a post-integration test I stop it. So I can reuse the concept on that, and I don't have to rewrite my test on that side. So what else exists? We saw that, okay, how to write tests for a single class that interact with the infrastructure. But what about testing the whole application? I mean, you can combine all these tools, but this could be a little bit tricky, like always with integration. But for this case, another test framework exists. It's calling Citrus Integration Testing, and he has possibilities from one hand that can handle what's about sending some stuff and verify on the end of my system on the test. And he looks in a test on the whole system and not only for classes. So this is a possibility. Okay, when I need some support for testing the whole system. But there are other tests like resilience tests. So I want to test if how my application works when, for example, the network is broken or something like that. Then I have, for example, ToxiProxy. It's a framework for simulating network conditions, and I think some reasons before test container supported too. And for Spring Boot application, you can use Chaos Monkey. So yeah, that was about testing and infrastructure inside software. So let's have a look testing and infrastructure as code. So again, the situation is that we describe infrastructure more and more in code. For maybe for some Docker files, because I want to use Docker in my infrastructure, or the classic way, I have some provisioning scripts like Ansible script, Puppet script, or other stuff. So when I look at how I can describe infrastructure, I have the possibility with shell scripts. It's I don't like shell scripts too, but sometimes it's the easy and the fastest way to describe infrastructure. But I can use provisioning tool or container on the side. Do you know other tools what I can use for it? Yeah, one example is Terraform, or I can use normal scripting language like Ruby, or like Perl, or Python. So there's a possibility too. But for shell scripting, there are test frameworks, so I will not go deeper in this topic. So, but let's look at shell script. When I say testing, I mean two kinds of testing. I want one point is I want to ensure my code quality. So if I have some syntax errors on that, or if I follow best practice on that side, and the other point is I want to test the functional of my shell script. And for code quality, there's a ChelseSec, for example. This is a website, exists a website where can you put your shell script and then check, for example, the syntax. And for example, my favorite failure always is I forget a plain blank between the cur and the condition. Yeah, because of reasons. And when you don't want to use the web interface for that, you can download it and use it on your command line. So you have feedback before you run the script if the syntax, for example, is correct on that side. When you want to test the functional, there are shell unit 2. It's inspired by JUnit. And so you can write test method that you know from JUnit, like test adding and some assertion, write some assertion. The important point on that side is that at the end you have to load shell unit 2 as a library that the shell script recognizes that here's a test code on the side. So when I look at provisioning tools, in this case I had a deeper look on Ansible. For Ansible, you can test the code quality with AnsibleLint or with YAMLLint. AnsibleLint checked best practice that they are specific for Ansible playbooks, and YAMLLint is YAML in general. And when you want to test the functional, there are three libraries outside there can be used for Puppet or Chef also. Their server spec is based on Ruby BDD tool, REC. So you have to write the test in Ruby syntax. If you don't like the Ruby syntax, you can use testinfra that is written in Python. So you follow the so you have to write the test in Python syntax. And because everybody writing the scripts in YAML, they are new library, it's GOS, so you can write a test in YAML on that side. So let's have a look on the Ansible playbook. This playbook wants to set up a Tomcat server, and first I want to check if my code quality is okay. In this case, for example, I break some best practice in Ansible. For example, all my steps are not named, and it's common in Ansible that, for example, every step should be described what he's doing, what it is doing. So, but what is about YAML? Because YAML is everywhere. When you look at the tools, Ansible has YAML syntax, SolidStack use YAML syntax, Docker Compose use YAML syntax, Kubernetes, and GOS. And for this case, you can use YAMLLint, then that it checked if your YAML syntax is correct on that side. And so the output give you feedback how you can improve your YAML syntax in the script. Yeah, when you look on the functional side, for example, you can test if your function or your playbook run correctly with server specs. So you have you write some tests. For example, if JDK is installed, is a special service up and running, and a specific configuration is set. And don't worry about this Ruby syntax. The documentation of server spec is very well. So I cannot write Ruby, but with the documentation, it's very very good, so I can copy the code snippet just in the way I wanted or how I needed. So, and the output of this testing library is like you know from other one. You have you show which step I was successful, and you have a summary how many examples are run well, and how many was broken. So, when you don't like the Ruby syntax, and this was the motivation of the people behind DesInfra, they say ServerSpec is a cool library, but we don't like the we like the Python syntax, so we rewrite a new tooling, and so you can write the tests like is common in Python. Here again, you look if some service is up or installed, some configuration is there, or some package are installed. And because TestInfra is a young project, they have some benefits. For example, you can say TestInfra, hey, the server used Ansible as provision tooling, so ask the Ansible configuration for the connections configuration. And so I don't have to rewrite the configuration for TestInfra. And at the end, I have the same summary like I know it from other test libraries. So I can combine this all tooling in my Jenkins pipeline, for example, because my code for infrastructure is, of course, in a version control system, like every code should be. And when there are some changes, a Jenkins pipeline runs, and they firstly check the syntax. Maybe the Ansible lint checker is running to check the best practice, the code quality. In the end, I run the Ansible scripts and test the result of the scripts in my environment. And at the end, I destroy my Docker container or my VM on the side. And with the so I have a fancy output in Jenkins where I can see in which step maybe my tests are broken, so I can have a good feedback about it, what I have to correct. Good question on that side is this is very little bit difficult because I have to combine this all tools, and the question is, isn't it easier? Yes, it's easier for Ansible. You have Molecule, that it's a wrapper, specialist for Ansible rules. That's a kind of grouping mechanism in Ansible for the playbooks. And this wrapper combines this all stuff. So you have the possibility to choose a driver provider like a Docker container or Vagrant that runs virtual machines like VirtualBox or VMware, but you can use a cloud provider like Azure or Amazon. Then you can choose a lint provider for checking the code quality and a verify framework for testing the function on the side. And in Molecules, looks like that you need this rule structure of Ansible, and additionally, you created a direction directory molecule where the tests are inside. And this is the test what we looked before, like the test infra tests and some setup stuff. So in the configuration of this tooling, you say, okay, I want to use a Docker as a lint, I want to use YAML lint. As a platform, please use a Ubuntu image, and in the next point, use again Ansible lint for the playbooks and for testing the functionality TestInfra. And a little feature is here that you can introduce a linter for the Python scripts to check if the Python code are following the best practice. So, and the test scenario molecules look like this, that he show you which kind of step he is testing, and one important point is that he's testing idempotence on that side. That means that he runs the playbooks or the Ansible script twice, and in the second time, no changes should be there. So to ensure that you are in the idempotence on that side. So on the command line, it looks like that, that I call molecule test. And first, he runs the lint to check if everything has a correct YAML syntax. Then he builds the Docker container for the test environment. And then he runs first the Ansible scripts, so he installs a Tomcat. And that should be, you see some changes because this system is blank. And in the next point, you will see that he will run this playbooks again. They will be hopefully faster. Yes, so this now is the step with the idempotence, and he say, okay, I run this twice and no change was there. And then he, at the end, he runs the test infra test, and then he destroyed the whole test environment. So now let's look at container. Here again, two topics, code quality and function quality. And code quality, there are two linter that are now, Docker lint and the Haskell Dockerfile linter. The Hadoo lint, in my opinion, is the better one of these two. And yes, it's written in Haskell. And the next point is function quality. You can reuse the libraries like test infra server spec or GOS, but then you use the Docker images like this will be a virtual machine. And you want only to ensure that a specific structure are inside your Docker container. So let's have a look on this Docker file. Again, I want to run a Tomcat server, and this time in a Docker container. So I write a little Docker file for this. And first, I want to test my code quality. So I run Hadoo lint, and he finds some pieces that are not so good. For example, I don't use pin version in apt-get install. Why is this a problem? Yeah, because apt-get install without pinned version always installs the latest version of my package. So I have not a reusable build on that side because I can have today another Docker image and as next week. And the next point is I don't use the flag now install recommends. Ubuntu have a user-friendly feature. He install additional packages when I install a special package because he think it could be that I will use it or need it. And in a Docker image you want to, or a Docker container you want that it's very small, and so you want only install the package that you really need on that side. So for the functional testing, it's more structure testing. You can use the container structure test from Google that you have the possibility to describe the structure of your Docker files. So you can write, okay, I expected some special entry points, some file access, that's some file access. Okay, you can say, hey, why I have to rewrite the same thing what I write in my Docker files? And in my opinion, there are two reasons, because not everybody in your team is a Docker specialist. I mean, this Docker specialist is on holiday, and some other have to make some changes on the Docker file. The Docker specialist can, or the expert can ensure, okay, can make some changes, but this test have to run because they are, this structure is very important. Or, for example, you use a base image and you change the base image, so you can be ensure that your expected structure from the base image is the same, or you have to do it something like that. Yeah, and of course, here again, you have a summary of the testing tool if every check passed or not. A very important thing on that side is it is required that you build before the Docker image, because the tests are running against the Docker image and not against the Docker file on that side. So coming to the end, I hope I could show you that you shouldn't be have fear about testing the right tests when they have to interact with infrastructure. It's very easy to have everything on the local machine, and I hopefully could show you that you can reuse your best practice method from the software development also for the infrastructure code stuff. So I think I have 2 minutes or 3 minutes for questions. So if you have some questions, ask. But I'm here on the conference the next 2 days, so maybe later. Yeah, thank you very much.